true. However, he did not, as he said in his speech today, choose peace over politics. He chose peace of mind that his legitimacy is safe over we the people. That is the ugly truth. Now let's debate it. Let's bring in Jennifer Granholm and Rick Santorum for a great debate. And the sound is so crystallizing. It is so significant. You cannot hype it. You cannot be hyperbolic. You cannot exaggerate it. I want to play it again for the audience before we debate it. Here's what the President of the United States said on the world stage about whether or not Russia attacked the U.S. election.
I have great confidence in my intelligence people, but I will tell you that President Putin was extremely strong and powerful in his denial today. And what he did is an incredible offer. He offered to have the people working on the case come and work with their investigators with respect to the 12 people. I think that's an incredible offer.
I didn't know if those were the shutters of the cameras or like people's eyes clicking in their heads when he was saying that, Rick Santorum. I love my intelligence people, but I believe Putin. And how about this great offer for him to take a look at our investigation so he can see if we reach the right conclusion? Do you accept any of that?
No, I don't. And I think the president's done some real damage to his administration. I think he is, as you noted, I do believe President Trump has a put America first policy, and he has followed it, I think, very, very well in a lot of areas. But the one area that he did not follow it was today. He did not put America first today. He put himself first. And I can understand it. Look, I'm not gonna apologize for it. But you know, he has been under constant attack by this Russian investigation. It has been the bane of his existence, and I think he saw this as an opportunity to try to put that behind him. But what he did is just the opposite. The chorus from both sides of the aisle. I don't pay much attention to the other side of the aisle on these issues because they get crazy on everything he does. But the fact that Republicans almost with unanimity has said the president's got to back this down, he's got to turn this around, he's got to correct the record, and he's got to be very forceful in confronting Russia, I think that shows you what a miscalculation this was by the president.
Well, here's their problem, Jennifer. He doesn't want to. He doesn't want to do that. This isn't about ignorance. This is about arrogance. He comes first. And he knows they won't do anything about him because at the end of the day, they're scared. So the question begins, what do you do about it, Jennifer Granholm? We've never seen a betrayal like this before, and that is not hyperbolic. This is the president and the first lady returning to a shocked America right now at Andrews Air Force Base. We are told he did not address the press in the airplane, Air Force One. That was a missed opportunity. So here he is now. What will he do next? Obviously, America will be watching. Jennifer Granholm, to you.
Yeah, number one, he has to ratchet up and not water down sanctions. Number two, I think Congress has to ask for the interpreter's notes, or there has to be some call to account for what was actually said in that meeting, and the only way to believe it is through what was written on that paper and what was immediately debriefed after. Number three, Congress has got to back off of this demand of pulling back on the Mueller investigation. You've got Jim Jordan, who has actually filed documents or preparing documents to impeach Rod Rosenstein. That has got to cut. They've got to cut that out. And they should, regardless of whether you think that Putin is going to actually extradite, the president should call for the extradition of these 12. And then for America, it is clear that you need a check on this president. And the only way you're going to find a check on this president is at the ballot in November, if the Russians don't continue to take this election away from us like they tried to do in 2016. Whether you believe it or not, the bottom line is their studies have shown there was some impact. And in 2018, if we don't stop this, then we're going to see it again.
Well, if I can, I think what you're seeing is a check.
Let's put elections to the side. Rick, go ahead. Make your point.
I think you're seeing a check on the president. I don't think there's any question that I haven't heard a single Republican defend the president today. In fact, they've been quite
Rand
tough
Paul,
on him.
Daryl Issa.
Okay. Well, I put Rand Paul in his own party, but I don't see.
And I would say that silence is aiding and abetting.
I think you're hearing a lot of folks speaking out very, very loudly, and I agree.
And bravo to you, Rick.
We have a list of them. If you can pull the graphic as Rick or Jennifer are talking, put up the graphic of who we saw today within the party when you get it, of the people who spoke out. A lot did. Not all. We've also never seen anything like this before. Now, this is a graphic of people within the Trump administration. That's a good graphic. You can put that back up. These are people within the administration right now who have said otherwise than the president today. And look, it's a good baseline, Rick, which is the damn truth. Okay, this is not an opinion point. It's not about whether Trump colluded or anybody in his campaign staff was involved in Russian efforts. It's whether it happened at all. And remember the clumsiness of his own explanation, which is, hey, this happened during the Obama administration, this thing which I'm now going to say didn't happen because Putin tells me so. So here you have Dan Coats, Chris Wray, obviously the head of the FBI, Mike Pompeo, obviously Secretary of State, Paul Nakasone said it also, and Gina Haspel, Senator, I do agree with the assessment. So look, it's not about the truth, Rick. You know, you gave him an excuse earlier. You said, well, you know, everybody's been after him about this. So what?
I didn't
Rick?
Give
that means that you don't
I
have to live up to your
I
oath?
Did not excuse I do not excuse what the president said. I tried to give you some insight as to what the president was thinking and what he was trying to accomplish. And I agree that I think it was a betrayal of the United States and in his rhetoric at that press conference. But I one of the things that I think could benefit Trump is the hyperbolic response by some like John Brennan saying that it's treasonous. It's what's always given the president quarter with his base, which is that everybody on the left just goes ballistic and goes overboard.
You think
on
the base likes what he said today?
No, I don't think they do. But I do believe that, for example, President Obama betrayed this country more. I think President Obama betrayed this country more with his deal with Iran. And giving billions of dollars to Iran to foment terror in Syria and other places. So if you want to look at policy, I think there's a lot worse policy out of the last administration than this.
No, it's not about foreign policy.
Chris,
it's about, don't surrender your high ground, Rick. Don't do that to yourself.
I'm not surrendering my high
ground. Listen, it's one thing to battle policy and say the Iran deal is a bad deal. You can say it all day. It's fine. Vladimir Putin doesn't agree with you, and the president says he's basically always right. But let's put that to the side. To say that President Obama ever betrayed the country the way we saw today, you know, has an absence of facts supporting it.
He lied to us about the whole Iran deal. I mean, he lied repeatedly. He transferred money without paying anybody.
Multiple parties on.
Can I just say,
come on, look,
Chris,
to go down a road like this at this time, Rick, you got to think twice about it. Jennifer, go ahead.
I'm sincere about
it. I just want to say this, Rick. Rick,
well, that's
I mean,
the problem.
I think it's terrific that you're calling out, Rick, that you are calling out the president today. And it's good to see these tweets. But talk is cheap. What are the Republicans in Congress going to do to make sure that this behavior does not continue? The behavior both of the Russians as well as this president who continues to bow to Vladimir Putin. What are the Republicans going to do?
I think it's important that this president do some things. For example, I mean, the gas line that he hammered Angela Merkel on, I think that's a great place to start. That will cripple Russia. Increasing contributions to NATO, that's something that Vladimir Putin doesn't want. I mean, there's a lot of things this administration can do, toughening up sanctions, asking for extradition. All of those things are things he can do.
The Republicans in Congress are the only way to check this president in the current cycle unless Democrats get elected in November. So what are the Republicans in Congress right now going to do beside their Twitter feed to check this president?
Well, you know, passing anything in this Congress isn't particularly easy, but I would think maybe looking at a Russian sanctions bill or something like that you could find some bipartisan support to send a message to Vladimir Putin that we don't share President Trump's opinion on his meddling in this in elections, and not just elections, the whole cyber warfare. It's not just meddling elections; it's meddling our economy and our infrastructure. I mean, the Russians and the oligarchs over there are a serious threat to this country on a lot of levels, and we have to start taking them a lot more seriously.
All right. And can I just say, stop using the word meddling. This was an act of war on our democracy. Meddling sounds like something your aunt does when she doesn't like your boyfriend. It is a much more serious thing than just meddling.
I would argue that Russia and their cyber attacks on this country and businesses in this country and our government are acts of war on a continual basis. I would agree with you on that. But I would say that Russia, I'm sure, in the past has meddled and tried to influence elections, as we have in other countries. That does not mean that we should allow for it. We should certainly fight, but it's at a much higher level now because of the whole cyber issue that we have to start addressing, and we haven't in all seriousness.
Well, either the president
and
calls
the reason
together
we haven't,
is,
we got to leave it here.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Finish your point, Jennifer. It's too important.
I was just going to say, you know, unless the president calls together his intelligence community and has a cabinet meeting that is all hands on deck to stop this interference in our election, people will suggest that the president actually doesn't really mind the interference in this election because perhaps he thinks that Vladimir Putin is going to help him again in 2018. That is very dangerous.
Well, look, let's end on a fact, okay? We have heard from a cabinet-level official that the United States government has not thrown into high gear any kind of anti-attack plan because the president hasn't called for it. If there was ever a time, it is right now. Rick Santorum, Jennifer Granholm, thank you.